Right, I'm back here again to help solve your technical problems, questions, queries, conundrums, anything tech-related that you throw at me. I'll do my best to answer. Let's crack on, shall we? First up is a question from Tevez, who wants to know what's the difference between a 110 and 130 BCD crankset. They know it's the diameter of the bolts, but they don't understand why we don't all just use 110 instead of 130. Also, is there any difference between a 55 tooth chainring on a 110 BCD and a 55 on a 130? Oh, right, I'm just gonna have to try and get my head around again your question, but basically, years ago, chainring technology isn't where it is now. So if you used a large chainring on a smaller BCD, the chainrings did tend to flex a little bit. I think I even managed to get one to flex once, and that's saying something. However, now it's moved on, and most manufacturers do tend to use a smaller BCD. So in effect, they don't have to make different chain sets for standard and compact users. One chain set can do all. As for the difference, using a 55 on a 110 or a 130 BCD, that all depends on the chainring being used and also how much power you are kicking out. So it's a very tough one to actually answer. Interestingly though, the standard BCD for track cycling is still 144, so that's pretty large. Reason being, they do tend to use a bigger chainring anyway, and then in theory, I guess, there's gonna be less flex of those chainrings. But hopefully that's answered your question. Right, next up, a question from Johannes Schmidberger, who says they've got a Shimano 105 group set and they like it. However, when shifting with either lever, they have to move them out 2 centimeters before they feel resistance and the actual shifting happens. Is there a way to reduce this dead space and to make the shifting more direct? Right, I'm afraid not. The reason being that it's not really actually a dead space, because when you're moving the lever over, you're essentially engaging or disengaging the ratchets to begin that gear change. The only solution with Shimano is to go to a DI2 group set, but admittedly, that's gonna cost you a bit of money because you're gonna have to get new derailleurs there too. Now, interesting geek fact here. Peter Sagan this year at Paris-Roubaix, he actually changed from the standard DI2 setup to using mechanical group set. Why? I don't know, I've not managed to ask him, but it could be that he didn't want an accidental gear change from the simple button press of a DI2 lever and wanted the more reassuring movement of a mechanical lever. So there you are. That could be actually a nice little nugget inside your head when you're riding along, knowing that Sagan won Paris-Roubaix on mechanical. Right, now Adam T has got a greasy question. Can leaving a chain soaking in degreaser for days or weeks at a time cause any damage to the chain? Really, really good question there. At home, believe it or not, I've got a chain soaking in degreaser for about the last 4 months. So it's inside of a plastic box and it's there in the bottom. The reason being, it wasn't that I could see into the future and knew that your question was coming in. It's actually just for a little project I've got going on at home. It started off filthy and now it is sparkling clean. Every now and then I go in and give it a shake just to try and get it a little bit cleaner again. As for does it affect the chain, I don't know. I'm guessing that there are some degreasers out there that are very damaging towards metals. I'm afraid I don't know if it's a good idea or not to leave it in there for weeks or months, but that chain is not going to be going back on my bike. But I can let you know one thing. I put a cassette and lock ring in some degreaser for a couple of weeks, and believe it or not, that degreaser, which isn't particularly strong, not in my opinion, it actually managed to remove the etching of a Dura-Ace lock ring. And the chain, the cassette is also really, really dull now. So I wouldn't recommend it on anything you want to reuse, just for the pure sake of if it does affect the structure of it. Okay, Matthew Hart. They've got a 2012 bike that they use for commuting and it's got a 9-speed drivetrain. What would they need to upgrade it to 10-speed? Cassette, chain, shifters, anything else? The wheels are suitable for a 9 and 10 speed already. Right, well, with all those components you've just mentioned there, you should be good to go, because a 9-speed derailleur will work with 10-speed shifters from every single one that I've managed to fit. I would also put some fresh cables in there too to take advantage of that time, basically, when you're putting on the new components. And also, you're gonna get some nice smooth gear changes. That's gonna be a nice little commuting bike, that. Enjoy it. Right, next up from Matthias Optebeek, they want to know, if you've changed your chain, do you need to lube it? Or is the lube that's on the chain enough? So Mateus, I think you mean the factory lubricant, or I hope you do, because that's the answer you're gonna get. So that lubricant, it's kind of like a sticky feel to it, isn't it? It's not slimy and it's not really chunky, but it's just about perfect, in my opinion anyway. I always leave it on there, and I recommend that everyone else does. And from memory, Shimano advise leaving it on their chains too. Now, the closest I've ever got to finding that lubricant is by buying some bottles of KMC lube and basically putting it into a tray and then rolling my chain around in it and then hanging it up to dry, and that got that way. But yeah, leave it on there and you'll be good to go. Happy riding, mate. Right, Kenny Henderson, they want to know, they've got themselves a 10-speed SRAM Red Y-Fly rear mech, and if they change the right-hand gear lever to 11-speed, can they use it and simply adjust the limit screws to suit the wider cassette, or will it not work smoothly? Now, good news, that rear derailleur will work just perfectly. But what you are also going to need to bear in mind is that if you're just going to buy one lever, is that the hood shape is exactly the same, because ultimately you want to have a good control and also good braking. Those two things, pretty important, I'm sure you agree. Also, make sure that the free hub on your rear wheel can accommodate that 11-speed cassette as well. Otherwise, everything you do would just be for nothing, because it won't work. So just make sure of that too. Right, final question this week is from Toby Price, who asks, they've got a problem with a rear wheel that keeps slipping. It's a quick release, and even if they tighten it up loads, it still moves slightly, meaning that the wheel ends up rubbing on the brake. That's never good. At first, they thought it may be the dropouts that weren't equal, but they are. Any suggestions? Right, Toby, I can relate to this. I once had a wheel that kept coming loose on a commuter bike, and I persevered and I kept tightening up that skewer and it just kept coming loose. So you could try a different skewer, but it's interesting it's coming loose and then rubbing on the rear wheel. I'm not actually sure without looking at it 100%. You could try a very, very thin washer on the end of the axle to go in between the axle and the frame to try and space it out a little bit. But personally, try a different skewer in there and see if that makes any difference. And hopefully you'll be problem free. Now, unfortunately, that one is the final question this week, so I'm going to close the questions. But do remember to leave me your questions in the comments down there below. And also give this one a like and a thumbs up too. Now, remember to check out the GCN shop at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com, where you can buy t-shirts, jumpers, hoodies, cycling kit, you name it. Hopefully, we've got it. And also, for another great video, how about down here for the latest Maintenance Monday?